start the meeting. Can I welcome everybody to this meeting of the Business Overview and Scrutiny Committee. A warm welcome. I'm chairing the meeting as the Vice Chair until it's decided officially we are at the next full council for the due and proper processes and channels. Unless anybody's got any issues. So thank you and welcome. Can I just say before we start, I would like to just briefly thank the former chair, for his work here on this committee over the last couple of years. I think it needs to be said. He worked across the political spectrum. I think he had accepted one law with the way he puts it. So I'd like to have that recorded, please, in the minutes for his previous work as chair of this committee. Okay. Can I invite members to declare any interest or party in
the arrangement? Could I ask for the Cllr to give some guidance on as much of the London committee then Labour have only got 8 members on the committee, and tonight we have a deputy. I'll go back to July, the one who voted that, and Gillian was appointed by council. All appointments appear to be made by council, but in this instance there seems to be no appointment made by council, and yet we still have 9 members on the committee. So Cllr, could you explain that to you, please?
With your permission, Chair, I'd like to do that. So the committee membership and numbers is something determined by full council at annual council. The way that individual places on a committee are filled are through effectively appointment through nomination by the individual political groups after council has determined what the numbers of the committee should be. Now, those members are appointed by nomination through a process of informing me as proper officer as to who is and who is not the nomination from that political group. The council is now in the circumstance that one of the Labour political group members has stepped away from the party, and I've been informed of that. The Labour group has, in the interim, removed that member from their group and therefore from the membership of this committee and replaced that person with someone else. The council at its next first opportunity will then receive a full report on the new political balance of the council and will have to appoint to these committees in accordance with the new political balance of the authority. But that process is set out in the local government committees and political groups regulation of 1990. It's regulation 17 if anyone's desperate to look it up. And that's the process that requires us to take this report to council as soon as reasonably practicable. And the next ordinary meeting of council is in October. And at that point, council will have a full report of the new political balance. We will have discussed it with group leaders, and council will be invited to make appointments in accordance with new numbers and individuals, because there will now be individuals who are not part of political group and follow that process.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for that explanation. Okay, can I also mention before we start, we're looking, as we agreed, at moving March's committee meeting to ensure it's not impaired and members will be notified. So I think spokes best to have you. Okay.
Can
we be able to assign the deputy for Chairman? Yeah, we have a deputy tonight, which is Christina, Muspratt for Sharon Jones. Okay. Number 3 on the agenda, the minutes.
Can you have them to the chair? Congratulations.
That's it. Sorry. Ian's built to my thoughts. Can I just mention the declaration of interest? The declaration of interest first, and then I'll come to you. Chris.
Thank you, Chair. I'll take some guidance off the head of the wall again. Item 5, the impact of universal credit. I will report to the Member of Parliament, which is also the Secretary of State, in regard to working pensions. I don't work in regard to working pensions. I work in a constituency one, so I'm based in a constituency and deal with constituency queries. Some of those queries from time to time could be around DPD matters that I don't know if I claim a personal interest or a prejudicial interest.
Chair, I wouldn't consider doing work for them being as of everyone's interest. That is what you said, wasn't it? Sorry.
I work for them too, yeah?
Yes, I wouldn't consider that an interest, no.
Okay.
Thanks, David.
Thank you, Chair. It's in relation to item 4. Financial update. As a builder of one of the schools,
sorry, I'm finished that question. Anybody else?
I switched the mic off without feedback. It's in relation to item 4, financial updates, and the Government of Wanderers School just mentioned in the report.
Thank you, Chair. Agenda item 5 was deferred from the last committee, and I declared an interest, my pecuniary interest, in this because by virtue of my membership as Chair of these local community councils and also the new member of housing.
Anybody else?
Okay. So, Chair, just to go back to the point that I also lately raised about that he works for the teacher work for MP, he works for the Minister of State, who deals with university credit. So, I just wanted to back to get absolute clarification that that's not any kind of potential issue.
Yes, Chair. So, in view of that, I know it's working for the Minister of State, but actually it's working for the Minister of State as an MP in a constituency role. And therefore, whilst there may be an extreme political interest in the outcome of all of this, it isn't something we would consider financial or would affect the finances of the body. It may affect the numbers in the House of Commons, but not the financial future of the House of Commons.
Thank you for that clarification. To be absolutely clear, I work for the Member of Parliament for Tatton. I don't work for the Minister, the Secretary of State for the Department of Working Pensions. It's an adjoining role, but I haven't wanted to do with that.
Okay, thank you. Okay, item 3. Can we agree the minutes of the last meeting? Yeah, and can I sign the minutes?
Chair. Yeah, just in terms of what we can do to the higher representation panel on page 9, it was nominated that Microsoft would actually be on that panel. I'm just wondering whether that's something you need to cover now or whether you cover a future meeting.
These are the minutes of the last meeting.
Maybe something you wish to consider for the next meeting when you have knowledge of how the committee is going to be constituted. Okay, thank you.
Okay. Chair, just one thing.
Tell me.
Thanks. Just on the minutes again, I'll go into the fact that I couldn't actually be present on the 4th of July. Just clarification on page 6, which was comments from Sally Shah. I'd like it making clear to myself that the council, this last paragraph, last bullet point, the council was now at a point where actual projects were beginning to happen at pace. The council was much more focused to tackle the economic and housing growth agenda. Just want to label the point there, that is actually like a growth agenda. It wasn't anything to do with housing need. We are actually focused on a growth agenda. That is correct in the minutes.
Financial monitoring board, I'd like to invite
Jenny Speck to present the report and deliver the presentation. Jenny.
What we've got is a lot of the areas at the moment are commented on this in the report, a lot of it is being mitigated or helped out by actions that are taking place. And then we have an understanding of finance and resources, and some of that again is through treasury management. And the fact that what we're predicting of the programme will be less spend than we anticipate, so we will borrow less. So that's the first thing. This is the capital on this committee, and the spend at the moment is quite low. We're at £2 million. It's obviously the first 3 months, but the intention is that there'll be more spend towards the end of the year, and some of the bigger schemes are in here around highways maintenance, around transport. There's also strategic asset purchases in here related to the road company. That's some of the areas where we've got more spend anticipated later on in the year as some of the acquisitions start. And then the final part I was coming to was around budget prep for 1920. Cabinet in July had the MTFS, they took the MTFS, they considered that, and it's obviously got details of the budget gap for next year as 45 million. There are also further budget gaps for future years. So it also looked at the approach to budget for next year and some of the strategy to looking at 18-19 in terms of looking for extra income, looking for growth in a number of our income sources, but also looking for things like efficiency, reviewing services, looking at how we can mitigate demand and some of the pressures that demand causes financially, but also about how we work with partners and how some of that work around sort of health helps with closing that gap. So in terms of overview and scrutiny's role, it is around looking at budget proposals when they come forward, or developing budget proposals that you've got particular interest in. And they can be from a wide range of areas. I mean, you've obviously got commercial strategy on the agenda tonight. You've got areas around income generation perhaps, with income services. You can propose proposals as well to cabinet, as well as examining the proposals from cabinet, which you can see the dates I put up here. Cabinet is due to meet on the 26th of November to consider proposals for the 1920 budget. And the plan would be then for opening scrutiny to scrutinise those proposals. And then that then needs to come back to cabinet and to consider. They will meet again in February, exactly the same as we've seen in previous years. And then the full council agrees the budget and the council tax is set in March, very similar to last year. I'm not telling you lots of things you know already, but it's just useful just to see that up there and understand how your committee fits in with some of these dates as well. That was a really quick run through what I was going to say, but to answer anything that anyone wants to raise.
Thanks, Jenny. Any questions, David?
Just a point of clarification, really, Jenny. You mentioned, I don't think it's here in the report, something to do with West Kirby flood alleviation. I don't know if anything has been done there yet. Can you just quickly identify what, if anything, has been spent and how much was spent, if it was? It's an ancillary question, really, Chair, if you just want a bit of clarification on that, because it does affect my residents.
I think when the report was prepared, nothing has been spent yet, but you can check and what's been spent since the report was done for you.
So when do we get that report then? Do you know what the process is on that? Because I know nothing about it. It's the first time I've seen that on the screen. And I just want a bit more information. Who can provide that information?
That would be, I will try and have the officer who's leading on that capital project and ask them to come back to you. Or I'll ask them to come back to you.
Could you send me an email, a brief email on that, please? Let it circulate it to everybody, just so we know what's going on. It's a key issue that's concerning me. Thanks, Chair.
Chris.
Thanks, Jack. Thanks a lot, Jackie. Just got a big figure saying, but the one figure that stuck out to me, £1 million spent on legal fees for children, it's an awful lot of money. Is that in particular...
The 1780s.
Is that in particular cases or is that a combination of cases? £1 million on legal fees for children's services. To me, it seems an awful lot of money. It might seem money to you, but to me, it's a huge amount of spending on legal fees.
It's related to the pressures that we faced in 1718 around children's services, the increasing numbers of children coming into the council and needing help and assistance. It's around those rising numbers.
Thanks, Jen. A couple of things, Jenny. Thank you for your report. You mentioned the vacant buildings, 0.5 million at the start of your report. I wonder if you could just explain a little bit more about what that was like. That was a big reason why that's.
Yeah. There are, in the budget, there have been savings for vacant buildings, rationalising buildings. So that is in there in the budget, but sometimes it takes longer for that to actually happen. So things like the municipal building took longer to dispose of than we initially anticipated when we put the budget together. So that's what some of the pressure is around. And we still have to pay costs, obviously, due to business rates, security costs. But we put together the budget anticipating the disposal of that.
And what was related to that, obviously, is the big time was on cabinet, I was doing quite a lot of work around income generation, trying to work with young entrepreneurs who are very interested in coming to come in and work as social enterprises to bring these buildings to life, so that not only are they left vacant, but they're actually going to be used as spaces in which people can come, buy tickets for events, that means business rates are getting paid by the occupiers, etc., etc. I'm really interested in to see how this committee, which is the business committee, can get involved in the second point I was to raise, which is us being able to make our own proposals about how we can do things that are innovative, exciting, that there's expertise around this table that could help. What's the mechanisms to make sure that happens and it isn't just a sentence that someone can say that they've said it and it didn't tick a box?
Tony Cox.
Thank you, Chair. It's timely to call me actually to tie in the first points of Councillor Spriggs has just said that I've got quite a lot of questions on this particular item, so I don't want to monopolise any, so I'm sure other people might ask the same questions. I'll just be able to feed them out so I can. And my first point is on page 14, and I think this has probably come from the Director of Governance, because he's very keen on highlighting the role of over review and scrutiny committees, because I've sat on a few where it's come up now. But for those who are not here during my first time on the council, and that would be most of the members opposite, and for what Councillor Spriggs has just said with regard to feeding in effectively to the decision process, I just want to make the point that we actually offered a committee system, which is what the council used to run on. And during the committee system, you would actually have that exact working logic and process. And it was thrown back in our face that the council decided that they wanted the strong leader model. That's exactly what they've got. It is a scrutiny panel. It's not a decision-making panel. It's not a help fill those job panel. It's a scrutiny panel. So that's just the point for that. I know that sounds very negative, but the committee system was offered to. Right, okay, so first question was with regard to the capital reports. We've got a capital program of 86.4 million, but we've only managed to spend 5 in the first quarter. So with regard to project planning over the 12-month period, what are we waiting on and what's the hold-ups with the rest of it?
Some of it will be around the fact that we need to do work to schedule the spend and actually refine down the 86 million. So some of it is we put the 86 in there, we need to do further work with the different project managers to basically get best forecasts around when things are going to be spent. Some of the 86 is around we've got some large items in the programme which will happen towards the end of the year. some of that's around that. And also, this is a bit sort of, when you look at the spend at the beginning of the year, we often have things in the spend that relate to the previous year that sometimes net off the spend you're seeing. So it does look low, but you know, some of it is around we need to look at the forecasts and revise some of those forecasts for the next quarter. So the 86, I do anticipate, will come down.
Thank you, Jenny. You asked for some comments about the rugby challenges put together, and the first time we saw them was at adults last week, and I think quite a number of us, and I don't know how this committee feels, felt that it wasn't put together very well. It was quite confusing. I mean, if we look at the agenda, we've got item 5 on pages 43 to 66, which is correct. There's also an agenda item 5 and sorted in the back of the financial section. So I appreciate that it's an overall. But actually, yeah, some of the information that you've given us there might have been helpful to have a purpose. Okay.
Okay, so what I'll take away is looking at what we can issue more tailored in advance related to more to the presentation for the next committee. Yeah, I can see now you mentioned it about the item 5. Yeah, that's how we picked it up from the cabinet report. Yeah,
I think that's been taken on board and doing this way from that. David?
Yes, thank you, Chair. Jenny, it's a good report. It's well read again. Next expectations from yourself. Two particular points I want to pick up on, but you might not be able to speak. The first one is in relation to the annual overspend by leisure services and others. We know there's a report that's been done in relation to leisure services. When are we likely to see it? I'll put that open to everybody because I believe it's been sat on for an awful long time. And it's something that we need to see and make it move forward because it's an annual thing, it's always small. We have this annual looking for it forever. The other point is in relation to 3.5, where we're talking about the changes with the growth income sources and the likes of building new homes and raising business rates.
Yeah.
I just take the position that at the moment could be reviewed. The Sprungbrough Village, which is next to my ward, is one of my residents shopping, where they're talking of taking the car park away for housing. You take the car park away for housing, there's nowhere for people to park. The village shopping centre itself will close down. So you're not going to get in either way there. So it's something that needs to be looked at strong and hard during the process that's being done at the moment, because it's the main centre now in the southern parts of the peninsula for shoppers, and it's got two banks. We've got two banks, and the shops closed, nobody goes there. And the rest disappears. So you're not going to get your revenue from domestic rates or from the business rates. And it's the business rate, as you quite well know, is the question I've been asking for years on this committee, knowing what's going on with the changes that have been set down by government. We're not going to get revenue from the government, so we've got to produce it ourselves. I understand the reason behind the thing, but then later on we'll be deployed. The thing that really does annoy me is that leisure services, we've had a review done, we need the answers, we need to find out where to stop overspending the money.
I don't know exactly when the leisure services review is going to be announced. I can take it back and ask when that's going to be announced. I'm not close to that particular project, so I can't answer that this week. In terms of business rates, I can see what you're saying. Yes, it would potentially affect business rates, and I presume that's the sort of thing that would be looked at in terms of planning development. But, you know, like I said, while some of it is, yeah, we want to keep business rates going, but then we also have to look at what we get through house building as well and council tax. They are all becoming far more important. Being able that's green is fine, and it's a new area for a lot of authorities and people.
Can I just come back on that to say it's the short term one. It's not something that they're thinking of in the long term, it's something they're hoping to do straight away. And that's a statement.
Hey, Cathy.
A couple of things. On the first presentation of the system, we noticed that in last year, in the first quarter of this year, it's just a bit 0.6 and 1,000 over spending. Am I correct? In the first PowerPoint, it's not enough. I would have thought that the overspend, bearing in mind that cumulatively from 1920 to 2021, the overspend has been bought by 17 million. I would expect in the first quarter, since the income generation is anything specific. We've got the short-term and medium-term growth, house building, the new business rates, and all the stuff we can invest in local economic development of the area and more self-sufficient economic growth. And we see the reward project, but that's not off the ground and that's not happening. So I would have expected to see that there would have been funding deficit much higher than the amount that's been shown in the first quarter. But also, on the capital programme of funding, it seems to be a lot of those are also grant money is not being spent. Is the inference that we will not spend grant money so that we will use money that is grant money, which is the money that's been generated by the council as a grant, to offset some of the overspend in other areas to make the economic forecast look slightly better?
Okay,
actually.
Sorry?
But
it
would be.
Okay, I will try.
We've got a lot of 15
Sorry?
Well, the thing is being this is passed on, and then there was a thing that we put forward as there was the next line on June, the previous one, but the figures don't seem to set up.
Right. If I start with the point at the end about the grant, the capital grant can only be used on capital, it cannot be used to help out with the deficit, which is on our revenue budget. And we can't do that if we use capital grants on revenue, our auditors would stop that happening and change it completely.
Okay, just say, it's just that on something like pothole action fund, was £563,000 for pothole, which I'm assuming is for the year, but only £33,000 has been spent, and most schools are crying out for money to be spent on potholes. So it just seems that you've expected a programme of pothole to have been done systematically through the year. In fact, probably over 9 months rather than 12, and the winter probably couldn't do it since you're over 9 months rather than 12. So we would have expected certainly in the first quarter, about that 563,000, at least a third of it, 175,000 or so might have been spent on potholes by now, not just 33,000.
Okay. I don't know exactly why
there's
only 33, but some of it might be because it's got spend from the previous year, it's still working through those figures. But also some of it may be just they are planning to do it later in the year after they've assessed the loans. I can find out in terms of their plans.
Because if they don't get it done sooner rather than later, what happens to the grant going forward into the next year if it's underspent?
This one, I would assume, needs to be spent in a year and usually be spent.
And if it's not, what happens to it then?
I don't know if it is when exactly.
Because it would be really rather than not on to have a grant of 563,000 which hasn't been for taxpayers and then we spend 33 on this.
That's only to say in the first quarter.
Then if you were to say that if you multiply that by 4, you would be 132,000 and something like that. Yep. So 132,000 only being spent of 563 is, as a councillor with the constituents crying out all the time, the potholes that we were. That money should be spent sooner or later, really.
But it needs to be spent in the most appropriate areas, and it's still, it may be around that there is still assessing where to spend it. Any other points?
Can I just ask the camera member, my voice going forward, give us an answer to two of your questions?
Guidance at the end of each financial year, how long it's been spent.
that's set out on the website.
Through you then, Chair, I have to ask, if 33,000 has been spent in the first quarter and we're coming up to the end now in the second quarter, how much has been spent between July and September? That's a significant amount more.
I've got the figures at hand, the way this programme throughout the year, and it's tied in with the service dressing programme, so we get maximum value for taxpayers' money. We're talking about the grant, not taxpayers' money. So could you let us know then how much you've been spent, or what is projected to be spent by the second half? Yeah, that's it. In the future, even those grants, it's taxpayers' money. So it's come from central government, it's taxpayers' money. So to get the best way of the money, it's programme, you know, in conjunction with the service dressing programmes.
Thank you very much. Councillor, the pertinent point is the fact that we've just finished the summer. It might be the first quarter, but we haven't even managed to spend 10% of the pothole programme, and I know what's coming in the winter will be. There's no point in filling them in the winter because they just come back out again. So if we haven't managed to spend even 10%, it's about, 6% of the budget. How do you intend actually managing to fulfil the criteria for how to fill a pothole during the cold, wet and damp months?
Can I just interrupt? I mean, without laying on the point, then you have quite a few questions on relevant points, by the way, all relevant points, fully understand that, but Council Whitting is saying that all that information is on the website. I think have a look at that first, and if you're not happy with that, then come back. And those points you just made, if they're not answered on the website, which he says they are, yeah, then come back and ask those other questions which you have some time.
I'll certainly look, Chair. It's just with regards to delivery, it doesn't sound feasible to spend.
What does that mean, Chair? What does that mean? Yeah, Cathy. Can we send further information after we can have a chat tonight at the end? Okay, thank you. And any more questions on any other issues? Christina?
Can you tell me, you mentioned that we would have to mitigate demand. What does that mean?
So, rising numbers of people in between, like old people from the social care, we are also working with health service partners to work on mitigating that demand, working across the sectors to try and reduce the amount of spending by having it. It's more efficient.
Can I just come back on that? Because the adult scrutiny committee, as the person, one of the people in that age group, and get quite touchy now about being blamed for everything. It was a kind of it might be better for you to be looked after at home, and it's more expensive in residential accommodation, all the rest of it. And that seemed to me to be almost like that's what would happen. I was a bit concerned. And now you've mentioned it again, and I find those words, I have to say, mitigating demand, rather chilling. And I'll have to say to my children, when I expect to have to look after me in the next couple of years as I get completely demented.
Okay, thank you, Christine. Any other questions? Chris?
Not a question, Chair, just a comment for something you said. As a scrutiny committee, I would expect us to be able to scrutinise decisions, to scrutinise papers, and scrutinise the decisions of the cabinet member, and not simply be put into websites. And that is the answer that the voters have in scrutiny committees, that is these other websites.
I agree, but Cathy is not speaking to the cabinet member at the end as well, as there can be further discussions. And I think also, if it's not, further opportunities as well. I'm not taking the wrong
question. I didn't speak to councillor directors at the end of the meeting because he has got the information and this is the point of the meeting.
Well, I mean, just speak to him in more detail and just see what he asked for.
Well, he has got the
quite important questions that Anna did say on the sort of
Do you have
another
question?
I've got two more.
It is
in relation to the figures that were within the booklet. The first one is the commercial settlement for Pan Muscle. Obviously, I never got the size of the contract when it was actually signed, I think, in 2014, because that would be £4, and I was not able at that point to actually get it. But we just signed a £305,000 settlement, which is a gratuitous waste of money in my eyes, the taxpayers' money. It was a £40 million contract, it seems to have called over a 4-year period. So when that was signed, surely part of the contract would have been that any capital investment could have fell to the actual contract rather than any liabilities falling to us as a taxpayer. Now, if we're taking it back in-house again, I appreciate that. But why are we getting given £305,000 settlement and needs? Does that mean it's still actually cheaper to take it back in-house with that £305,000?
As I understand the assessment is done, some of this is about the fact that they've got assets and equipment we need to make sure that everything's operational when it becomes part of the council, and that's what that is.
So we're effectively purchasing it rather than reimbursing them for any investments they've made, which is what that sounds like.
That's what I understand.
Okay. And the last one was we've gone on to capital programme financing. So, the borrowing in particular, this is page 33 of the report. See, we're looking at actually borrowing, we were going to borrow £33.5 million, and now we're going to borrow £45 million, £45.3 million to be precise. Now, does this involve the £26 million that we intend borrowing to lend to a private developer in order to level my ward on the leader's pet project, the golf course? So the question is, the £26 million, does that involve, include that, or is that on top of that?
Chair,
that is
that
involves
the borrowing to ask for these questions?
It would be much better to ask these to the cabinet member, but she's not here, so I don't have any choice.
I also say in terms of scrutiny, I mean, we do have task initiatives, we do have workshops, we do have further opportunities for members think items should be brought forward along the way forever. There's always opportunities during the year you feel strongly and you feel something not being tackled properly on one of these meetings, yeah? Please bring that forward, Cathy and anyone else, and yourself, Tony, through your spokespersons. It's very important because, you know, we're looking towards suggestions, not we? We all work together.
Continue to answer the question of Councillor Cox in terms of the contract. So the contract